Good day, everyone. There is a lot of happening in the automobile sector. On one hand, we are seeing newer models receiving reasonably higher bookings, while on the other hand, the semiconductor chip shortage is posing to be the biggest challenge to the supply. Amid these mixed signals, today we have with us Mr. Sachin Trivedi, who is not just the head of research at UTI AMC, but also the fund manager of UTI Transportation and Logistics Fund. Hi, Sachin. A very warm welcome to the show.
Yeah, hi. Thanks, Sagar. Thanks for giving me this opportunity to talk about auto sector.
I am excited for the conversation today, Sachin.
Yeah, hi.
Yeah. So, Sachin, right off the bat, would love to hear your views on developments in the automobile sector specifically.
So, yeah, actually, I would want to bring back the attention of all the listeners is that, yes, you pointed out that there are a lot of difficulties within the sector at this point in time, which you, one of them you pointed out is the semiconductor issue. And that's just really forcing all the manufacturers to scale back on the production side. But remember, this sector has faced multiple challenges in last 3 years, and which is what is, if you were to look at the performance of auto sector, auto index versus, let's say, the broader indices, these indices have underperformed by more than 40%. And reason for that is very clear. The volume performance for many of these or for the sector has actually, has the volumes have declined in last 3 years, ranging from 30% to, in some cases, even as high as 40%. So that's the reason behind this are multiple. But in a summary, what's happened in last 3 years is that there have been multiple regulatory changes, be it the BS3 to BS4 transition or BS4 to BS6. So basically, we have skipped one full generation. Never, ever this has happened across the globe, right? And on top of that, there are several regulatory changes with respect to safety, be it that now the safety in terms of what kind of safety gadgets will go in, let's say in simple language, the airbags are now compulsory in the car, right? Even the basic model, or let's say in a bike, the ABS is very much compulsory. And then there are several reinforcements has gone. Now, when you try to go and buy a vehicle for the third party insurance for 5 years is compulsory for five-wheelers. So these are small nuances actually with which people have not paid attention to. But the fact of the matter is that in the lower end, the cost has gone as high as 30-35% or even higher. And that's actually pushed out multiple players from the buying bucket, and which is where you see the volume issue. Now, the other important point is that we believe that clearly those regulatory cost inflation, which have happened in the system are behind us, and which is where we are quite excited that going forward, we will find that we'll find that the incomes which will start to grow, and which is what will bring in the additional buyers in the system, but the cost won't go up materially, and which will be the big, big driver for the industry growth. That's where I'm super excited about. And remember, with volume, what you get is operating leverage, pricing power, and all this will result in material or let's say volume growth plus the all these factors will result in superior profit growth for the auto sector.
Interesting, Sachin. Sachin, we would love to hear more on, how do you see the chip shortage situation progressing, and what could trigger a turnaround in the situation? Because that is the problem right now in the industry. So how are you looking at it?
So see, the problem in the industry started because this industry, auto as an industry, which is 7-8% of the overall chip market demand. The problem globally started for this industry in the COVID environment, because this industry globally was enjoying a lot of just-in-time kind of a situation, a lot of buyer's kind of advantage which the industry had over the semiconductor industry. So what has happened in the COVID environment is that the companies, the auto industries, have just cut back on their demand, And the consumer industry, which is nothing but a PC or a mobile, has just lapped onto this situation, and they have given firm orders to these industry, and which is where you found there was a mismatch got created because the demand came back much superior than the industry expected. And you suddenly found yourself in the situation. Now, this situation actually got further deteriorated in the wave two in some of the Southeast Asian countries like Malaysia, where the workforce, the workforce has lost close to 4 to 8 weeks. That's where the shortage has been. Before that, we never, as an Indian industry, did not face much of a problem. But now what we're given to understand is that, and just one point which I want to further point out is that at this point in time, the auto industry demand is further increasing because we are using more chips in the car because there are more features in the car, right? So, but what we're given to understand that this situation is already started to normalize, but the full scale normalization which will happen will be closer to which will be next calendar year, which is somewhere first or second quarter of 2022 is when the situation should normalize. When I mean to say normalize, it means that it will be able to meet the increased demand of the industry. So remember, when we make this assumption or the discussion, everyone is expecting that the industry will grow, and that growth demand would be met by the chip industry. So which will mean that it will no longer be a bigger issue in 2022.
Very well explained, Sachin. So Sachin, right after the semiconductor chips, the hottest buzzword in the automobile sector right now is electric vehicles, what we call as EV. It is almost a known fact that the world will move towards electric. But there seems to be more time before the real infra for more efficient vehicles, the charging stations and the battery swap facilities really ramp up. Okay, so how do you look at the EV space overall? What's your view?
So it's you are perfectly right. The penetration globally, we would be selling close to 3 million odd vehicles of, let's say, on the passenger side. That's the that's the number which is there in last calendar year. In India, however, this penetration is much low. Let's say in car, it would be maybe early 20,000. In two-wheelers, we sell good, but it's a mix of lead acid and the lithium-based vehicle. But let's say in specific months, this penetration could be as high as 6 or 8% in a city like Bangalore, where the adoption has been much higher. But what we're given to understand, based on the usage pattern. By usage pattern, I mean that how much a vehicle owner drives the vehicle in a day. The availability of infrastructure, which you rightly pointed out, the charging infrastructure. And the third factor, which is to do with what is the cost of these vehicles. If you put the combination of three, clearly we believe that the penetration of this EV would be first higher in the two-wheeler segment. Within two-wheeler, it will be largely scooters. And post that, it may be the commercial vehicles of the three-wheelers where the adoption may be much higher. But really, the cars or the motorcycles will take longer because simply the cost of manufacturing has to come down. Now, what we're given to understand is that in some of the high-end EVs which are available, which is what the consumer desires to buy, the cost of manufacturing for a scooter could be as high as 1,50,000, 1,60,000. But they are selling them at 1 lakh rupees, right? The rest of the gap either is the loss to the company or it is the subsidy provided by the government, which are non-sustainable on a wide scale basis, which is where the cost has to come down, the localization has to happen, the government has to give incentive for the manufacturers to bring down that cost. So clearly, EV penetration is going to increase, but the real big adoption need to actually go through several tests, and which is where you will find that people will look for alternative options available, which is in India, especially be it hybrid or the CNG. And clearly we have seen the CNG penetration in the cars, in the commercial vehicles has increased materially. So there will be intermittent period where you will find this adoption and eventually will move towards EV.
Yep. I think Delhi has already started, or you know, they have they are going to adopt, you know, the CNG plus electric vehicle model there, right? So
yes.
Do you see other states also adopting the same model there on, and we can see some traction there on?
So certainly states are quite progressive in supporting electric vehicle, and which is where let's say a state like Maharashtra, there are, if you apply for an electric charging point, there are special rates at which you will get those charging points. So clearly the states are adopting, and not just that, they are also giving you subsidy to purchase those vehicles. But remember, this is to make people to come into the system so that the economics become more progressive. But at this point in time, the challenges are a lot. Let's say a busier city like Bombay or Delhi, there are no, let's say, other than public, let's say Sachin Trivedi's car or Sagar's car is standing in a building. It is, it's not necessary that you have a dedicated parking infrastructure, right? Yeah. In absence of that, to provide for such an infrastructure is a big, big challenge. And for public charging infrastructure, in absence of government subsidies, the IRRs are really are in actually, to be frank, negative, and which is where the real challenge is. So the localization is the key theme which the government has to drive. Once you get those volumes is when the cost will come down. That's where the real boost will happen.
Interesting insights. Very well explained, Sachin. Sachin, let's shift gears a bit. Okay, we have talk about EV. We have talked about the chip shortage situation in India. There are also talks about commodity inflation also adding a lot of pressure on the automobile manufacturing and then their margins. Okay, so what's your views on topic of rising input cost, and is it as a large concern as it seems today?
Yes, you are right. Industry has faced such challenges in past and is facing this challenge at this point in time as well. So when you look at the stocks, of course, they look expensive because the profitability of these stocks have gone down materially as well for the sector. Now, one of the key reasons for some of these companies is that their gross profit margin, which is nothing but the selling price minus the cost of production, the in terms of the raw material, the gross profit margin of most of these companies, or many of these companies, have gone down materially just because the input prices have gone up. Be it, let's say, because of this BS transition that you've seen, you need to use a lot of expensive commodities where the inflation is 2x or 2.5x. And that's where the real challenge the companies are facing, that at one end, the consumers were facing income-related challenges, and at the same time, the companies were unable to pass on the entire price hike. Remember, companies can't increase the prices. Let's say your input prices have gone up by 10 or 20%. You cannot overnight pass on that cost. It has to be a gradual curve, which is where companies are also facing challenges. But like I explained, this has happened in past. Companies have managed their margins by gradually passing on to the consumers, and we expect the same to happen in future as well. So that's where there is a clear demonstration by the industry in past. And the good part is that many of these commodities have started to cool off, and which is where you will see the tailwind for the industry.
Got your point. Interesting. So while we have spoken about the factors influencing the automobile sector, we'd also love to hear your thoughts on more nuanced segment of chemical, batteries, OEMs, and other ancillary segments. How do you look at it?
So, like we've discussed on the EV side, we clearly believe that some of the lead acid-based battery players would find the business as a big challenge, right? Because essentially for them, they do supply to OEMs, as well as the good part of their profitability is also coming from, let's say, the replacement market. But like we all understand, in the EV era, the lithium-based batteries have long replacement cycle, and that too, most likely it is going to be replaced either by the OEM or their alternative, because that's a large part of the battery vehicle. So, which is where we believe that the newer business structures have to emerge over a period of time, which is where as an investor, we can't give them the longer term value multiple, right? And that's where we find this this business model is going to evolve over a period of time. So that's one challenge. Similarly, there will be a lot more newer areas will emerge. Like in the EV era, the business the vehicle has to be a lot more smarter compared to the vehicles which are available today. In terms of basically what I mean is there will be a lot of electronics and electrical components, including the software, will go in. So there will be newer and newer players will emerge in that era. And that's where the real opportunity lies for the investors like us. And we have to keep our eyes open there. One more thing which I would want to point out is that, which is to do with the auto ancillary sectors as well. In this entire painful period, this industry has also been facing the challenge with respect to the volumes. But this industry is much bigger beneficiary, the auto ancillaries, is because every change in regulation, every additional feature as a consumer we want in a car, that's a new business opportunity for the auto ancillaries. And now they've become a much larger player in the global arena. They've got the technology. So they are not just catering to the domestic demand, but they are also started supplying to the international supply chain. So that's definitely an exciting opportunity for the investors to look into.
Interesting. Sachin, you know, as we move towards the end of this conversation, okay, as a final note, what are the key triggers that you feel investor interested in investing in a theme like automobile transportation and logistics? Because you are the one who is managing a flagship fund, UTI Transportation and Logistics. So what's your views? What are the key triggers that you feel investor interested in investing in a theme like automobile?
See, investors, big money for the investors is made when investors look at beyond the near-term noises and they really focus on longer term, let's say medium to longer term, which is 2 to 3 to 4 years, right? Or even longer than that. So what we have to focus on, clearly auto as an industry, if we look at on the longer term basis, it's a growth industry. This industry has been, let's say, if you were to look at the growth for the industry, some subcomponents, be it the PV or the two-wheeler, if you look at their volume growth, it is anywhere ranging between 8% to 11%. On top of that, there is an average selling price, because each year the price of the vehicles keep going up. So this industry is clearly a growth industry with a healthy growth run rate. Now, the other factor that we have to keep in mind at this point in time, when investors is looking to invest in this theme, is that there has been a degrowth in the industry. So there has to be a definite catch up, which will happen in the industry, which means that the near-term growth in the industry could be a lot more stronger compared to what we have seen in past, so that they go back to the old growth trajectory. But along with that, Sagar, what we will find is that there will be operating leverages, because the fixed cost remains fixed. So as you sell more and more vehicle, large part of the gross profit margin, which is every incremental vehicle you sell, large part of that net contribution actually straight away goes to your bottom line. And on top of that, if you if the commodity prices further goes down, that will be an additional tailwind for the industry. So which is where I clearly believe that there's going to be a much or lot more stronger growth as far as the profitability of the industry is concerned. The factors that we should keep in mind, which is the risk factor for the industry, if at all there is another third wave, this expectation may be getting pushed out by another 6-7 months. But definitely, the longer term trends, I believe, because our penetration, let's say the car penetration is just below 3% compared to some of the developed market where it is much, much higher. Even China, it is 21%. US and other countries, it's higher than 50-60%. So we have a lot more ground to catch up, which is where the longer term growth will remain sustainable, and there is a very good opportunity at this point in time, wherein the medium term growth could be a lot stronger than the longer term growth, and along with that associated profit growth opportunity.
Very well elaborated, Sachin, I must tell you. This brings us to the close of this conversation. Personally, this has been an extremely insightful conversation for me, and I'm glad we were able to do this. Okay, thanks a lot for sharing your perspectives around automobile, the problems, challenges, along with the opportunities. I'm sure it is as valuable to our viewers as much as it was to me. Thank you so much, Sachin, for giving your time for our audience.
Thank you, Sagar. And wishes to all the investors and happy investing. And thank your listeners also. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so
Bye-bye.
Much.
Thank you.
Investment and securities market are subject to market risk. Read all the related documents carefully before investing.